So I bring from all the cities I visit my hearty greetings from Jaipur, Chandigarh, my hometown of Malda, and the city of Dibrugarh. So today I'll talk on male factor infertility, a clinical perspective. So male infertility, it's around 15% couples suffer from infertility. A male factor is responsible for 30 to 50% of cases, and 5 to 10 of males are infertile or subfertile. Spermatogenesis, as we know, that 74 days it takes in humans. So whenever, as a clinician, you are treating a patient, please give around 3 months of treatment. Then only expect something of a better result in your semen analysis report. So that's what it's the clinical correlation is need to wait for 3 months after any intervention that is medical or surgical to see a change in the semen quality. Etiology of male infertility, there is multifactorial. There will be varicocele to idiopathic, infection, genetic, endocrine, and obstructive. And lifestyle changes is the main thing that causes it coming down to 5%, but I think now it has changed up to 35%. The lifestyle change should go on the top. And the other causes of infection, I have already told, right? Acute and chronic, then injuries, then the previous surgeries in the inguinal, scrotal, or retroperitoneal region, the obstruction, vasectomy, or post-infective. And systemic illness like hepatic, renal, or immunologic, the spinal cord lesions, and the genetic factors or the familial factors, clean filter syndromes, Young syndrome, cystic fibrosis, adrenal hyperplasia, and etc. So there are many causes of male infertility, but lifestyle changes is the main factor now which causes the male infertility. I'll explain it later to you better way when I'll give example. So when you do evaluation of male infertility, it's history, physical examination, standard semen analysis, hormonal evaluation, then genetic counseling and evaluation, and imaging studies. General examination, it's height, weight, thyroid, and the secondary sexual character. Local examination, then we go to scrotal volume, testicular volume, epididymal palpation, presence of varicocele in PR examination. As a gynecologist, we spend very little time for the local examination of a male patient, but we should do that. Then coming to semen, as you all know, semen is a secretion of testis, epididymis. The maturation of sperm occurs in the epididymis. Then seminal vesicles give around 60% of the fluid, and then prostate comes to the milkiness of the semen, and then it also kind of gives the maintenance of the spermatozoa. Coming to semen analysis, it's macroscopic and microscopic. Macroscopic, we see the viscosity, the coagulation and the liquefaction time, the volume and the pH. Microscopic, we see the concentration, motility, morphology, and viability. The motility and viability must be performed within 1.5 to 2 hours of the collection. So please tell your technician or who is doing the semen analysis to do it within 1.5 or 2 hours. Remember, semen is a biohazard material. So whenever you are handling semen by yourself or by your lab technician, please tell them to wear gloves. Semen collections, the period of abstinence should be around 2 to 4 days. 2 to 7 days is not required. The time of collection plus analysis should be recorded because it should be within 2 hours. The entire ejaculate should be taken in a wide mouth container in a lab, delivered within 15 minutes of collection. So your semen collection area or the semen collection room should be adjacent to the andrology lab, and avoid temperature extremes. Please don't allow your patients to collect it at home because you never know whose semen is coming. So if your patient is telling that I'll collect it from the room of the hospital, or telling that I'm staying nearby, I'll collect it, so that time please take a consent that it's his own semen. Coming to macroscopic examination, semen is viscous, yellow grayish, forms gel-like clot immediately, liquefies completely within 20 to 60 minutes. Appearance, it's homogeneous white-gray. In case of hematospermia, it is brown or red. less opaque if there is low concentration of sperms, it's dense white turbid in inflammation and high WBC, or you have infections. So this is the WHO criteria of semen analysis in a normal way. So volume should be more than 2 ml, and the concentration or the count should be more than 20 million, where we have a motility of more than 50%, a morphology of more than 15% of normal sperms, and the viscosity less than 3. We need to have at least 2 semen analysis because parameters are highly variable. So you take an average of both, and it's semen analysis is not a measure of fertility, but the fertility potential. So in case of motility, you please be sure that the semen analysis grading is given as A, B, C and D. If it's like rapidly progressive to slow progressive, here you can see on the slide that these are the different microscopic picture of semen analysis from fluorescent microscope to stereozoom microscope, from a CASA and electron microscope. So coming to sperm, sperm is a 55 to 65 mm micromillimeter in length. There are 3 parts: head, neck and tail. So we have the most important part in the head, that is acrosome, which gives you the hyaluronidase and the proteolytic enzymes for fertilization. Then you have the tail, that is called flagellum, that causes the motility. And a normal sperm move in a fluid medium at a velocity of 1 to 2 millimeter per minute. So the sperm motility, as I have already told, it is A, B, C and D, where you have A like straight line, good rapid progressive motility, B is slow movement, C is sluggish movement, and D have no movement. So patients with abnormal motility should be evaluated for pyospermia, anti-sperm antibodies, varicocele, sperm ultrastructural abnormalities, or partial ductal obstruction. The abnormalities like oligospermia, asthenospermia, teratospermia, oligoasthenospermia, all of you know all these terms, what it means. Azoospermia is no sperms, aspermia is no semen, hypospermia and hyperspermia. So these are the different morphological structure. You can see the double head, double tail, and the rough head, the long tail. Here you can see the other microscopy in electron microscope. You can see the sperm head defects, midpiece defects and tail defects. Now coming to CASA, normally all the centers are not having CASA, you don't need it. It's mainly for the purposes where they are doing research on sperms and all. So I'll go to the genetic evaluation. You do karyotyping, you know, 44XXY or XYY, so Y chromosome microdeletion, cystic fibrosis. The genetic evaluation is recommended in all infertile men with severe semen parameters in order to assess and prevent possible iatrogenic transmission of genetic mutation. So this chart is almost showing the genetic etiology of human male infertility. I'll not go into detail of that. You can see it. The other investigation is fructose, semen culture, urologic evaluation, transurethral or transscrotal USG, and scrotal thermography. Radiological testing like scrotal ultrasound, CT scan or MRI, testicular biopsy, which we are doing very frequently nowadays. The hormonal studies less than 10 million, then we do the FSH, LH and the total testosterone. Coming to serum FSH and testosterone, these are the combined results of endocrine abnormalities. So FSH reflects more on the sperm production. So FSH more than 4.5, that will give you abnormal structure. So basically we are doing hormonal evaluation if you want to do oligoasthenotic sperm. Azoospermia, we do testicular biopsy, but if you are doing testicular biopsy, please remember, if you are having a setup of ICSI, then only go for testicular biopsy. Otherwise, there is no point doing a testicular biopsy where you can't freeze the sperm sample if you get sperms. So we recommend your patients a center where you have ICSI, then only do testicular biopsy or TISA. So this slide, you can see the normal sperm movement during fertilization, and you can see the hyperkinetic movement we need during fertilization. So this is the hyperkinetic movement you are seeing on your slide. So these are the normal sperm movement and the hyperkinetic movement for fertilization. So this is in vitro maturation of germ cells. I will not go into detail of this. The sperm DNA integrity, why we want, we are doing the sperm DNA fragmentation test nowadays in our clinic regularly, just to give the patient a better idea whether there will be any medication required before we go for IVF or ICSI, because to understand the causes of IVF and ICSI failure, we need to have a DNA fragmentation test. And in our clinic, we are doing it regularly. The DNA damage is showing on this, which causes the difficulty in fertilization and pregnancy. Antisperm antibodies is 5 to 10% of infertility attributed to antisperm antibodies. So we have the etiologies here, I have already told. So testing is in decreased motility, and so this is the most important slide, where you have hyaluronidase binding assay. This gives you the fertilization chances of IVF, or in ICSI we don't bother about this because we are injecting directly. So the main causes of male infertility is oxidative stress, which is coming from spermatogenesis and affecting almost 25% of infertile men. So ROS is the reactive oxygen species, is the mechanism of damage that we are getting. This slide is showing you the ROS production and how it is damaging the sperms, the DNA of the sperms. So the type of ROS is free radicals and all in our day-to-day life. So origin of ROS is lifestyle, environment, genitive urinary tract infection, systemic infection, testicular, chronic diseases and idiopathic. So origin, you can see smoking, alcohol is the main cause, excessive car exhaust or the pollution we have, like the cities of Delhi, excessive exercise, the obesity and psychological stress. This is the main factor for ROS productions now. And it is called that mobile phones can have an effect on ROS, and the electromagnetic distribution will cause a damage to the sperms. Environmental factors, I was talking about the phthalates. The place where I come from, in the city, the Malda, we have the mango and the flowers of the mango that gives you the pollens. These pollens are very spermatocytic. So because of these pollens, it affects the sperm analysis, and you believe me or not, 50% of the Malda population is azoospermic. And we did a data and we presented a paper on that. So the general treatment is education, the coital frequency and timing, avoidance of substances, drug abuse, weight reduction, avoidance of hot bath or tight underwear, then lifestyle modification, environmental exposures, treatment of infection, inflammation, direct treatment of oxidative pathway, vitamins and antioxidant supplements. So antioxidants like stop smoking, weight loss, avoid heat, diet rich of antioxidants, and wear loose garments, give vitamin E, vitamin C, vitamin B complex, lycopene, and lastly gonadotropin injections. Clomiphene citrate 25 mg per day for 90 days will give you a good count increase. Antioxidants action, it basically protects the DNA that is damaged by the ROS. So vitamin B12, folic acid, zinc, vitamin C, I am not going into the detail of the slides, vitamin E, selenium, L-carnitine, coenzyme Q10, and these slides is showing that all of these will protect the damage of the oxidative stress that causes the DNA damage. So all of this will help in reducing the oxidative stress on the sperms. So the endocrine treatment is, we can give pulsatile GnRH or HCG or HMG, but mainly it is on a factor that if we give endocrine treatment, the patient may respond within two months. So giving antioxidant is as good as that. So these are the flow charts, like how we should treat the azoospermic. And if the patient is azoospermic, go for TISA. If you have the facility of ICSI, then do a TISA. Then spermatozoa present, do a cryopreservation and ICSI. If no spermatozoa, go for adoption or AIDs. Asthenospermia is the same thing, like you do antisperm antibody testing and follow the chart, decrease of motility or increase of motility, and then you can go for ICSI or you can go for AIDs. So this is the chart which is showing WHO criteria or how to go for ICSI, IVF and IUI. So ART for infertility, we have the treatments of IUI, IVF with embryo transfer, cryopreservation and ICSI. So this is IUI, you all know how IUI is done. We take the semen, wash it and then push it inside the uterus. We are not a sperm bank. As a clinic, we cannot be a sperm bank, but sperm can be cryopreserved for almost 10 years. So this is IVF, where we do the ovum pickup and preserve it, and then we mix it with the sperms and develop embryos. This is the embryo development. You can see the 8 cell to a blastocyst. And this is embryo transfer under ultrasound guidance. This is cryopreservation of the sperms. This is ICSI, where we are injecting the sperms directly in the oocyte. So this is not needed of screening. And obstructive azoospermia, you know, reconstructive surgery or the testicular aspiration is as good as that. So testicular aspiration is very easy process. We do it, you can see in the picture, we do it very easily under local anesthesia. And the management of non-obstructive azoospermia, you can give HCGs or GnRH pulsatile, or you give medications of clomiphene and give antioxidants, that will be enough. So in conclusion, main infertility is multifactorial: hormones, physiology and the environment and anatomy and DNA all play a role. It is the delicate balance of all of these factors that must be weighted in order to optimize male fertility. Every evaluation is different and every treatment strategy is geared toward the individual patient and circumstance, and must always take into account of the female partner, because we are talking about male, but we should remember the female partner is also responsible. So there is no evidence that semen quality and pregnancy rates improves in men with normal sperm count after surgical treatment of a clinically apparent varicocele. The benefits of treatment of varicocele in oligozoospermic men is less certain. So IVF and ICSI are the effective treatments for male with moderate to severe semen abnormalities. ICSI has made it possible for men with only few sperms to become fathers, and sperms for ICSI can be obtained by TISA, or directly from testicular biopsy, as well as aspiration from epididymis. Last slide, cloning in male infertility, it's coming up, where we can do from a skin cell cloning and create sperms. So this is the flowchart I have given of Srishti IVF in Dibrugarh, where in 2017 all our ART results I have shown, we have got a beautiful result of 45%. In 2018 we got almost 49%, so that is excellent, and thanks to all our team for an excellent result. Thank you very much. Thank you all for a lovely talk on male infertility and bearing me with all the talk. Thank you.